Possibilities. We gather to sing our song of gladness and to share your steadfast love. Some of us have come out of the shadows of our life. Others come seeking new life. Some of us are unsure of what we're looking for, but we hold to your promise of the gift of life, new life, for the tomb has been conquered. We come to you today in the risen Christ. Friends, Christ is risen and we live in him. Hallelujah.
Christ is risen. We live in him.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. May we now join our call to worship.
Call to worship. Look. Life is here, even when the tomb is empty. Even when the tomb is empty.
Even when death is all around.
Believe, for hope reigns victorious.
This is the gift of resurrection.
This is the miracle of the resurrection. Hallelujah. Amen.
Amen. And now I invite the congregation to arise as we join together in song, My Redeemer Lives.
The moon, where to
Easter. Did Easter Bunny come?
Yeah.
The Easter Bunny didn't come. The Easter Bunny is actually in operation.
His operation. That makes sense. So I don't. Well, I tell you what. He stopped by. And I don't know what it is.
What? What?
Yeah. What am I going to do with a plastic egg? Are you guys excited about these? Why?
Because there's one inside.
Oh!
Something exciting!
Oh, I didn't realize that. Candy?
Yep.
I think I'll share this with you, but I only got one.
One. Don't worry. The eggs come to everyone.
I have an ambitious, I know for a fact that the Easter Bunny is working right now and he's getting eggs up and up around the church or after the church. So, you're going to get your own. Oh, you guys are really analyzing this. No, you don't have to. What does this have to do with our church service today? What do you think? Good inside, like the tomb. That's a good answer.
Jesus wasn't in there, so that's a good thing.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. Nice.
So.
Yeah.
See, it's kind of a tough question, right? Because when the pastor asks you a question, we all know the answer is Jesus, right? Right. And you say Jesus, you're like, oh, you guys are so smart. But yeah, see, you know, it's not that this piece of plastic is why we're here today. But we have this egg with a treat inside as a reminder of the goodness that happened a long time ago. Where bad things happen, but through God's love and grace, good things come forth. God made good things out of things that don't stop off that grade. Okay? Because this wouldn't be that great if there wasn't any sweet inside, right? So, here's the thing. What I want you to remember this Easter is that your life is it. You're going to call the name of Jesus. You don't know?
I mean, if someone calls you an egghead, that's
true. Egghead. Alright, that's my cue to sum up. What's goodness is inside of you. Just waiting to burst open and share with everyone around. Because like this isn't that good if I keep it to myself, is it? You guys like that?
I would.
You definitely would.
I would.
Now this is just a taste of the goodness. This is only one little M&M.
I think M&M's enough.
Reflect upon, where am I in this story of resurrection. And I'd like to hold on to that thought as we continue our worship service this glorious Resurrection Sunday. I'd like to invite Sean forward. And as Sean comes forward, we prepare to join in our prayer of confession. This is a magnificent opportunity for us to take inventory of our brokenness. Not to feel guilty by the mistakes that we've made, but rather to be reminded that within us is goodness that God has placed. And as we surrender the things that are driving us down, we give thanks for the resurrection and the gift of new life that has been offered to us through the forgiving grace of Jesus Christ.
May we bow our heads in prayer. Holy One, we are tired and a little terrified. We do not understand the confusing world around us. It is easier to live in the darkness than to walk toward the light. Forgive us. Open our eyes to see your presence among us. Open our hearts to receive the risen Christ walking toward us. Fill our hearts with amazement, wonder, and hope. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen. May we now take a moment to silently lift up any areas of brokenness to our forgiving God. Brothers and sisters, siblings in Christ, we are witness to the resurrection story. As witnesses, may we find hope in Christ and be assured of God's grace, forgiveness, and steadfast love. Amen. Amen. And now invite us to hold up our Bibles as we join together in celebrating God's Word. Every scripture is inspired by God and is useful for teaching, for showing mistakes, for correcting, and for training character, so that we can be equipped to do everything that is good. Amen. And may we now prepare our hearts, our minds, and our souls for this morning's scripture lesson.
Our first lesson today comes to us from Psalm 118, verses 1 through 2 and 14 through 24. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say, his steadfast love endures forever. The Lord is my strength and my might. He has become my salvation. There are glad songs of victory in the lands, in the tents of the righteous. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. The right hand of the Lord is exalted. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. I shall not die, but I shall live and recount the deeds of the Lord. The Lord has punished me severely, but he did not give me over to death. Open to the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. And our gospel lesson comes to us from Luke, chapter 24, verses 1 through 12. But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they came to the tomb, taking the spices that they had prepared. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they went in, they did not find the body. While they were perplexed about this, suddenly two men in dazzling clothes stood beside them. The women were terrified and bowed their faces to the ground, but the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here, but has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee, that the Son of Man must be handed over to sinners and be crucified, and on the third day rise again." Then they remembered his words, and returning from the tomb, they told all this to the 11 and to all the rest. Now it was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the other women with them who told this to the apostles. But these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them. But Peter got up and ran to the tomb. Stooping and looking in, he saw the linen cloths by themselves. Then he went home, amazed at what had happened.
The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Earl. I now invite the congregation to arise as we join together in song, Christ the Lord is risen today. Amen. Let us pray. O gracious Lord, we thank you for giving us your word and the gift of new life. We pray, O Lord, that as we hear your prophetic message and the good news from our gospel lesson, that we are lifted within our hearts and soul. And gracious Lord, I pray that you are glorified in spite of my weaknesses. As we pray to your name in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. Well, happy Resurrection Sunday and happy Easter to you. We come together in an unfamiliar space. It seems like we made it far enough away, perhaps, from COVID to join once again in a full fellowship. I was going through my notes in preparation, and I realized, I'm like, man, we haven't really met in full capacity in a while. But I praise God that as we come together in fellowship of this new day, a day of celebration, that we take a moment to reflect upon the struggles that we have had in the past years, but again, give thanks for the gift of fellowship and the unity of new life. As I was reflecting upon this scripture and this week and preparing for the Easter message, Earl came walking into my office this morning. And I said, "Earl, I got a problem." He's like, "What's that?" I said, "As I was reading the scriptures one last time, something just really stuck out to me." And he's like, "What's that?" And I said, "Well, the three women that were mentioned in the Bible today." I'm like, "What do they mean?" He said, "That's a really good question to be asking about an hour before church service. That could have been a lot handier for you to research, you know, earlier in the week." And I said, "Well, no worries." I said, "I did my due diligence. I still prepared a message, but anybody that knows me, you know, when I'm hit by the Spirit, I just can't let it go." And Earl reminded me of that as well. You know, there's a message before I talk about the women in this story. There is a message for us to be bold in the scripture. You know, I think back years ago when I first felt called into ministry, how terrifying it was to stand before people to preach and proclaim, who's little old me to proclaim the good news. I think of times and experiences throughout the ministry that I've been called of much spiritual gratification, but also times of much fear. Being out, putting myself out there in front of people. You know, they say it used to be that public speaking was one of the biggest fears around, but I think maybe because of social media, that's not as much so. But for us old guys, it is. There are many times within our scripture readings, within our spiritual walk as Christians, that we become afraid. Now, I think many of us try to hide that fear because of appearances of what we represent. But what I absolutely love about this morning's scripture, as we gather in the hope and promise of the resurrection, is that it actually talks about fear. You see, I think the mistake that many Christians make, when they have the revelation that God is real in their lives, real in their community, whether it be within their immediate family or the community outside in the world, is that we are no longer held bound by such things as fear. But the reality is that's not true. It just opens our eyes to the fact that we no longer walk alone in our fear. The Easter message is such a magnificent understatement message that perplexes the world. I've been doing a lot of research lately on TikTok. And guess what the latest trend on TikTok is this past week? Did anybody guess? It's all about the resurrection. Yeah, you see the regular stuff. They always have like somebody wearing a Biden hat or a Trump hat, and then they start yelling and fighting and all this. But no, this week everybody's an authority on the resurrection. I actually said to one person, I said, "You think maybe you should ask a couple more questions instead of having all the answers?" And he said, "No, I'd rather give answers." Oh. Is what the resurrection is and what it isn't. And behind them in the blue screen, they have a chart of things, right? What they believe and don't believe. I believe that the resurrection happened. I believe it didn't happen. And they give all the reasons why. They talk about history from different points of views. And every single post was an argument. Every single one. And I had a rebuttal. To keep that argument going, right? To poke. I lead with my chin and say, "I have a master's degree in theology. I know more than you." I said, "No." I said, "All of you are missing the point. How can a message of new life coming out of the most horrendous instrument of death of the time lead us to arguments. I didn't tell him I went to seminary. I didn't tell him I was a pastor. I asked that question. How can it be that with the tomb being now empty, whether someone believes it physically or not, if it's a symbolic expression within their life, or if it's an absolute 100% truth, how, even if we're on different sides, how can that divide? For the great divider, that being death, is the great unifier. It doesn't matter if you're an absolute wealthiest of billionaires, or within the statutes of our nations of the poorest of poor. No one can escape this. And therefore, no one can escape the good news that is given to us today. We can argue, we can fight, we can wrestle, or we can start celebrating life. I love the Easter message. Rather than saying what we don't believe, may we live what we do. You know, there's a lot in this morning's scripture reading, and I'm not about to stop and tell you that I'm a pastor that went to Wesley Theological Seminary and have a master's degree in theology and start explaining it all to you because I don't know. Isn't that amazing? That no matter how much I study, I will never know on this side of eternity of how magnificent and good our Lord is? If you have a building question, I'll give you an affirmative answer. If you want to know what to do with a structured wall that needs to be moved, I'll tell you right what to do. And in the 20 years of my studying, I am more convinced today than I ever was that I just don't know. But boy, do I love spending time in the subject. For when we spend time in the subject, that being the creator of the universe, so good. I've shared with all of you before, if you're effective in school at seminary, you leave there having more questions than when you entered. That's a successful experience in the seminary, and it's one for us today. But it's not one to walk us in puzzlement, but of wonder. Look at this morning's gospel lesson. Not one person in the story, besides of the angelic beings, know what the heck's going on. Because their unity in death has been defied. I don't know. Let's continue this journey together, is our Christian expression. Not why I'm right as a Methodist and you're wrong as an Episcopalian. No. How do we, in this small church, in this small community, start becoming a message of the defiance of life that conquers the grave? Well, that brings me to what I was contemplating this morning about the three women in the scriptures. It says that Mary Magdalene, most of us know her, right? Joanne, we don't know her. And then Mary, mother of James. Now I told Earl, I said, don't be giving away the punchline on this, because Earl instantly said to me, oh, well that's, and I said, shh, shh, shh. Who's the mother of James? And I told Earl, I said, well, you know, there's some debate in the answer he gave. And he said, why could there possibly be debate? I said, well, because our Catholic brothers and sisters don't want to accept the fact that Jesus had brothers. The mother of James is Mary, the mother of God. So I was reflecting this morning in all this preparation an hour that can give you. And I started thinking about why did they name these three people by name? And just on a side note, I love the fact that all the people that came out that day were women. And in their defiance of saying, in spite of all, we're here. We've got a job to do. Mary Magdalene, to me, represents the person that was about to be stoned unjustly, to be found guilty by the people around her and liberated by God. Imagine, if you will, you're this person that was saved by Jesus in an intimate way. When he holds her by the hand and says, "Where are those that accuse you?" And she says, "They are all gone." "Then I don't accuse you either. You have been forgiven." Imagine what she must be feeling as she's walking to the tomb of the one that liberated her. Joanne, she was healed. And she's attributed in the scriptures for her faith that she had before she was healed from a physical ailment. One has been liberated from an unjust society inflicting a punishment upon her. The other was healed from an ailment within us. The third, Mary, son of James. Why did they just say it was Mary, son of Jesus? And I think why they did that was to remind us of the pain that a mother felt in that moment in the loss of a child. Where are we today? You know, the angels say, or the images, the people in the beginning of the narrative say, "Why? Who are you looking for? Why do you look for the living amongst the dead?" I have a question for you, and it's in our bulletin today. It's the title of the sermon. Why are you looking? Why are we looking? We are all looking for something. We must be, or we wouldn't be here. Are we looking for a place for multiple different reasons? Am I looking for a church to give my children a place to have fellowship? Am I hurting in my heart and I'm looking for liberation from that? Why do we go? And what are our expectations once we come? Okay. I once had a person share with me years ago, when I was outspoken about a certain ministry that I cared about in the community. And the person met with me in private and said to me, they asked me if I would back off a little bit from my position. And I said, "No, I can't do that." The detail's not important. But the comment that followed was, the person said to me, "You know, Pastor, I believe in being a Christian, for I am a Christian too. But, that only goes so far." I think about that story quite a bit because there are times in my life where I probably have said the same thing. You know, I believe in being a Christian. I believe that we should do name a ministry of Jesus. And then follow it up with a but. But as we gather today and we walk to the tomb, we see that there are no more excuses. For if God can liberate us from death, there are no more buts. I believe in what cause for humanity that you care for. I believe that all children should be fed. Amen. No but. You see, feeding the children is easy when God brings us new life. I believe in helping the poor, but no but. Amen. For God has conquered the grave. Name it. Now, I want to be careful because I don't want to be having a TikTok moment here where I have a list behind me of all these things and people will say, "Oh, you're just being political, Barry." And I say, you're right, I am being political. I have chosen to follow the king. A king? We're liberated from a king. No, a kingdom that's been redefined through the unity of life towards all humanity. That's the Easter message. There are no more buts. Now we have a choice. We can argue, we can fight, and we can continue this divide that is festering within our nation, within our community, within our homes. Or we can choose to live. Why do we look for the living amongst the dead? What are we looking for? Why are we here? I am going to go on a limb and say that each and every one of you here today, in some form or fashion, is looking for more life in their daily life. And here's the good news. It's given. But if you think we can celebrate this daily gift of life and the remnants of holding on to the broken ways of the world, well, we're in between like today's gospel message. Half in the tomb and half out. It's not a bad place to be because it's the start of a new journey. But once we see the resurrected Christ, I invite us to no longer linger within the tomb, although empty as it is, but rather take in the full fragrances, the beautiful smells in this church today of new life. You see, that is not what they expected when they came to the tomb. Far from it. God has took something that was nothing, no life, nothing. The only remnants that would remain would be the stench of death. Is now elevated to the smell of beautifully baked bread in the background and flowers before us. God makes all things new. God is making us new. Let's come together and be part of this. As I conclude this message, I've often shared this at the pulpit at Easter time, and I find myself needing to be reminiscent of it one more time. And this is for the children out there, too. You guys listen? When I was a kid your age, I went to a sunrise service. And I was sitting in the pew saying, when's this guy going to be quiet? I want to go home, and I want to open up my Easter basket. And then he said something, the pastor that day said something, while I was squirming in the pews, and he said, you know, every Sunday is Easter Sunday. And I had to spend a lot of time thinking about that, so I said, this guy is so full of it. He's full of baloney. I don't wake up every Sunday and get an Easter basket. So I thought about that. How can every Sunday be Easter if I don't get an Easter basket? And then I realized what he meant. That every day is a gift given to us. Sometimes it's dressed up in a fancy basket. Sometimes it's fancy little Christmas presents under a tree. But every single day, we are given a special gift that is put in each and every one of you, like that egg I showed earlier. And I realized that pastor was wrong, that not every Sunday is Easter, but rather every day. Every single day, we have a choice to remove the stone from the tomb and to open our hearts to our community and to express the life that is all around. For a new life that's held behind stones is no good. Now, one of you guys told me that right now the Easter Bunny is in activity. He's in motion. That motion's kind of cool because it's an invitation for us to also be in motion. May we take this message and truly celebrate it by sharing a message of hope of new life to others this week. Amen? I would like to now invite the congregation to arise as we will be joining together in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Virgin Spirit, born by the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He ascended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. I'd like to now invite Brenda forward as she will lead us in the prayer for the people.
Morning. This morning we have some things to rejoice for because Jerry L. came through surgery well. He's in the rehab that he and Linda were hoping for. May he find healing and strength and peace, and Linda too. Baby Luke is well and thriving. The two families looking for housing have found them. God bless those homes and all who go in and out of them. And Katie her progress is in healing. She's had progress in healing. Let us pray for Antonio Gooding, Donna, healing, health, and strength. For Linda and Bob, continued healing and strength. For Brianna, please give her healing, wisdom, and freedom from fear. Nancy, who has a fractured spine. Michelle Watley, recovering and strength. Peace, as peace talks take place between Russia and the Ukrainian leaders. We pray for peace here and abroad. Jennifer A., for healing, health, and strength. Continued prayer for Dylan. All on our hearts and all God puts in our path this coming week. For our leaders and the leaders within your world. All on our hearts. May we lift up in voice any joys or concerns. Heavenly Father, on this day that we are rejoicing, let us rejoice for all the healing you have done for your people. We praise Jesus for all the ways he showed us how you want us to live and love. Please continue to heal the sick and suffering in our world today and on our prayer list. Thank you.
Amen. Thank you, Brenda. May the peace of the risen Christ be with you all. Amen. And now as the ushers go forth, I invite us to lift up our tithes and offerings and to ask ourselves and enjoy a celebration with this gift of new life on how we can be a living offering to be an expression of new life to all the world. Together in a cappella. Love and gifts beyond comprehension. We ask, O Lord, that as you call us into sharing of the generosity to all those that we meet, that you send your blessing upon this offering, that it goes out into the world, into your world, that may share in the good news of the resurrection. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I invite you to be seated. May the Lord be with you. We lift up our hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and good and joyful for you, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, O God Almighty. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity of sin and death, and led us into a land filled with milk and honey. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, may we now join together praising your name in this unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus the Christ. By his baptism, suffering, death, and resurrection, you have given birth to your church. You have delivered us from both slavery of sin and death, and liberated us now into new life. By your great mercy, you have been born anew, to the living hope, to the resurrection, that all may live in unity. And may we now declare the mighty acts that have taken place in our lives of past, present, and future in the name of Jesus Christ. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always through the power of the Word and of the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this as often as you eat of it, in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, again gave thanks to you, O God, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you, for this is the cup of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us all. May we now join together in the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. O gracious Lord, we thank you for pouring out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and cup. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ that has been redeemed and shared with the world. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ and one with each other as we go forth into this fellowship table and join together in the gift of new life, through the hope of the resurrection. And through the power of the Holy Spirit, may our hearts ascend in joyous celebration at this meal as we go, as we celebrate within the heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God. Amen. And now, with the full confidence of children of God, may we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Behold
body of Christ, which has been broken for us all. Behold the cup of salvation, liberating us from both sin and death, so that we can be joyous in the celebration of this holy meal.
A crown of thorns placed on his head. He knew that he would soon be dead. He said, "Did you forget me, Father? Did you?" They nailed him to a wooden cross. Soon all the world would feel the loss of Christ.
Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, amen. And as we prepare to close in our final song, I'd like to remind anyone who ordered flowers that if you would like to take them with you today, you're more than welcome to after the church service. And if you would like to leave the flowers, that they will be going into the church's garden. And one final announcement is that we are having a brief Easter egg hunt for the children outside the church, but we just ask that we wait for supervision for us to make sure that you don't run out into the street, right? You stay in the grass. All right. May we now arise as we join together in song, Christ Arose. This day and this gift of new life. May we not squander it. As we go forth and join together in fellowship with loved ones, as we give thanks for those that you have in our lives in this time and place and moment, and bless us in the heart and in the places of our hearts where we mourn the loss of a loved one. May we be unified through the eternal promise that Christ is risen. We pray to you, O Triune God, in the name of Creator, Redeemer and Sustainer, one God forever and ever, and all of God's people said, Amen. Amen.